Hi all, myself Vishnu S. Babu, a project associate in Dr. Senthil Kumar Muthappa's lab in National Institute of Plant Genome and Research, New Delhi. Today I will be discussing about the topic Artificial Neural Network Based Applications in Agriculture.
So first of all, I will make you understand how computers learn, what is the similarity between the learning process of the computers and the human beings. For that I have given you an example of plant classification. So we know that we can classify plants based on inflorescence pattern or phyllotaxy, etc. But earlier scientists might have used root tip length or shoot tip length in addition to this inflorescence pattern and phyllotaxy. So upon learning only, they came to know that there is no point in using root tip length or shoot tip length to classify the plants. Similarly, it is a computer or machine should also be supplied with enough of data to make future predictions like weather forecasting. So it's like a baby who initially doesn't have the ability to walk, but gradually upon falling many times, he or she will gain that skill of walking. Similarly, this concept can be used for predicting diseases in plants. So the only thing is that that a computer should be supplied with enough amount of data for both the diseased plants as well as normal plants. So in the future, if we provide the data of an arbitrary plant, that tool should predict whether it is useful, it is under any threat or it is under any disease threat or not. So next is artificial intelligence. As the name suggests, it is the intelligence shown by machines to solve a particular problem. This is actually a technology which is being widely applied in the field of robotics and all to make finish off a task, particular task, at a much faster speed than the human capability. This artificial intelligence has subcategories like machine learning and deep learning. So the first subcategory is machine learning. As the name suggests, the machines will learn based on a sample data known as training data in order to make future predictions like weather forecasting. Some of the machine learning algorithms are decision trees, support vector machines, etc. So the next subcategory is deep learning. So compared to machine learning algorithms, the deep learning algorithms learning process is much more stringent and rigorous. The one of the main algorithm which is being used under this deep learning category is artificial neural networks. This particular algorithm is actually being inspired by the structure of human brain. So how this works is that artificial neural networks takes in a data and trains themselves to recognize some patterns and then predicts the output for a new set of similar data. This is a basic framework of an artificial neural network. It has got an input layer, hidden layers, and an output layer. Each of these small circles represents the neurons of this network. These neurons are identical to those neurons present in our brain. There, those neurons take up the information, process the information, and ultimately transmits the information through electrical and chemical signals. Here, in the case of artificial neural network, each neuron is connected to the next layer by means of channels. Through these channels, information is being transferred from one layer to the next layer. Here we don't know what is there in the input layer and what is there in the output layer and what all information can be provided as input to the input layer. So in order to understand this, I will give you an example of a protein-protein interaction predictor. So here what all information can be provided as input to the input layer? Information regarding hydrophobicity, volume of side chains, polarity, polarizability, solvent accessible surface area, and then net charge index of side chain chains, etc. can be provided as input to the input layer. Output layer will ultimately determine whether a given pair of proteins will interact or not. So next is, how can we decide on the number of hidden layers for a particular artificial neural network? Actually, we can add as many number of hidden layers as we wish. After a specific number of hidden layers, if we keep on increasing the number of hidden layers, it won't increase the overall performance of the artificial neural network compared to those previous ones.
Next is the application of this artificial neural network in the field of biology. Recently, it is being widely used for predicting whether a person is COVID positive or not by scanning the X-ray images of the lungs of that particular person. So X-ray images of the patients and normal persons were trained by this artificial neural network, and then finally a tool will be generated.
This newly generated tool will then be used to predict the whether a person is suffering from COVID or not. Similarly, it is being used in agriculture field for predicting agriculture plant diseases based on analyzing the different images of leaf or root or shoot. Next, we will look at how learning is done by these artificial neural networks. What is the purpose of these hidden layers? So in order to make you understand this, I am going to show you an example of a number predictor. Here I am showing you this example to help you understand the algorithm of this artificial neural network, that is backpropagation algorithm. Here I have shown the image of a number 9. This 9 is actually having a total of 784 pixels, and these pixels will be fed as the input to the artificial neural network. In the output layer, the network predicts the number as 9, but still we doesn't know what is there in these hidden layers. So now I am going to show you the images of this number 9, 8 and 4. So this 9 can be broken down into basically two down into a loopy structure and a tail in the bottom. And this 8 will be having a two loops, one in the upper side and one in the lower side. So basically this 4 also can be broken down into three specific lines. So now we can think of a situation like each of these neurons in the second last layer basically corresponds to these subcomponents of these numbers. So now what is there in the second layer? That is the question. So in the we can consider that the second layer corresponds to each of the tiny little edges made out of these subcomponents, that is these loopy structures. So every time when we give a number to predict, what it will do is it will divide it into tiny little edges, subcomponents, and then finally it predicts the number. If the predicted number is wrong, it will send back an error message to all of the previous layers and it will rectify that error. That is, the error was in the previous layer where they have fired the neuron representing wrong substructures, which will finally predict a wrong number. So now once this error is being sent back, correct set of loopy structures will be fired and the correct number will be predicted finally. So now the question is, does the network actually do this? The goal is to have some sort of mechanism that could conceivably combine these pixels into edges, or edges into patterns, or patterns into digits. So in order to understand this, you should first understand what is this neuron. What are the values of these neurons in the hidden layers? How is it being calculated? What are these connections between these neurons? So in order to understand this, let's take the same example where we have taken the image of number 9. As I have said before, it is composed of 784 pixels. Each of these 784 pixels are fed as input to each of the neurons of the first layer. Neurons of the first layer are then connected to the neurons of the next layer through channels. Each of these channels are assigned a particular numerical value called weights. The inputs are multiplied to the corresponding weights and their sum is sent as input to the neurons in the hidden layer. Each of the neurons is associated with a numerical value called bias, which is then added to the input sum. It is this value which is then passed through a threshold function called activation function. The result of the activation function determines if the particular neuron will get activated or not. An activated neuron transmits the data to the neurons of the next layer over these channels. In this manner, the data is being propagated through the network. This is what is called forward propagation. In the output layer, the neuron with the highest value fires and determines the output. The values are basically a probability. For example, let's say that the artificial neural network predicts the number as 8, but the actual number is 9. So by looking at it, we know that it is wrong. But how will the computer figure this out? Or how will the artificial neural network figure this out? Note that there are networks set to be trained for the remaining 9 digits from 0 to 9. During this training process, along with the input, the output is also fed to it. So here, during the training, the pixel values of all the 10 numbers are given as input, and the output will be all those 10 numbers from 0 to 9. The predicted output is compared to the actual output to find the error in the prediction. The magnitude of the error indicates how wrong we are, and the sign suggests whether the predicted values are higher or lower than the expected. This information is then transferred back through all the layers in the network such that the error will be deduced from each of the weights and biases. That is, weights and biases are adjusted. This is known as backpropagation. This cycle of forward propagation and backward propagation is iteratively performed with multiple inputs. This process continues until our weights and biases are assigned such that the network can predict the numbers correctly in most of the cases. This is how training on learning is done. Next, I will introduce what is this dried root disease in chickpea. DRR is a disease is one of the economically important disease in chickpea. DRR causes around 50 to 100% yield loss under favorable conditions. Some of the symptoms of this DRR are drooping and chlorosis of petioles and leaflets. Next is leaves and stems of affected plants are usually straw colored, and in some cases the lower leaves and stems are brown. The taproot turns black with signs of rotting and is devoid of most of the lateral and finer roots. Next, DRR disease incidence increases under drought stress, and there is a positive correlation between drought stress and DRR incidence. So there is a necessity to develop an in silico tool that may help to predict the DRR occurrence in different locations and years. Favorable conditions may be rainfall, temperature, soil edaphic factors, etc. This tool may be helpful to find the correlation between the edaphic factors and DRR disease incidence. This graph basically shows the correlation between the dry root rot disease incidence and the yield of chickpea. So as you can see, as the dry root rot disease incidence increases, the yield is getting reduced. Next is data collection and building the tool. Here I am showing you an example of how a dry root rot disease predictor is being made. First of all, the data for dry root rot disease incidence is being collected from various reports and theses. Corresponding weather data is also being collected from Indian Meteorological Department from four respective locations. Screening of the data is being done, and only those features which are related to dry root rot disease incidence are being used to train the data. Remember what I have said in the first slide, that is regarding the plant classification. There we have taken only phyllotaxy and inflorescence pattern for plant classification, and we have ignored root tip length or shoot tip length for classifying the plant data. Similarly, here we have considered a lot of features, out of which we have selected only few parameters which are correlated to dry root rot disease incidence. There are these are temperature data, rainfall data, genotype data, and soil type data. So these basically comprise the input layer. So next is the total data is being divided into training data and test data. Training data comprises of 70% of the total data collected. Remaining 30% comprises the test data. It is in this training data the artificial neural network algorithm will be applied. A small sampling step is also being done such that the training data is randomized and subdivided into small subsets. Each of these subsets we can apply the algorithm, and then final tool will be generated by merging all the tools generated from these small subsets. The final tool is having the correct set of parameters, that is weights and biases. This final tool was applied onto the test data set. After applying it to the test data set, it was then later on applied to a data set which was not there in the data collected. After all these steps, we have computed the predictive performance of this tool, and it has got a predictive performance of 85%. Conclusions are: using artificial intelligence, early detection of diseases is possible and targeted treatments can be started. It solves the scarcity of resources and labor to a large extent. Adoption of artificial intelligence is quite useful in the agriculture field. For example, weed eliminators can be made out of the application of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence can be a technological revolution and a boom in agriculture to feed the increasing human population of the world. These are the list of resources and literatures used for making this presentation. Before concluding, I would like to thank my guide, Dr. Senthil Kumar Muthappa, for giving me this opportunity to present this topic.